Thank you, Maharaj. Srila Prabhupada also, our own founder Acharya, Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, was very fond of mangoes. In the early years of our movement, Srila Prabhupada had one secretary, a young woman, a married woman. Her name was Govinda Dasi, and her husband, Gorsundar, they were serving Srila Prabhupada very faithfully. But Prabhupada wanted them to go and preach. He sent them to Hawaii. Go to Hawaii. Make a Krishna conscious center there. Now, Hawaii is a nice tropical place, like a paradise, like the heavenly planets. You know, people often want to go to the heavenly planets to preach. I mean, why go to hell to preach? You know, better to go to the heavenly planets, right? And we have to preach, so okay, let's go to heaven and preach. So they were sent to Hawaii to open a center. And Govinda Devi Dasi knew Srila Prabhupada very well, and she knew Prabhupada's love for mangoes. So she was regularly corresponding with Srila Prabhupada, and she wanted very much Srila Prabhupada to come there and visit them. So she told Srila Prabhupada, now is the mango season, Prabhupada. They have the most wonderful mangoes here in Hawaii. Just like Maharaj was describing, you know, big ones with very little skin and hardly a stone. Very sweet. What, Alfonso's is it? The big one in India? Alfonso's the famous... India is famous for Alfonso. Yeah, there are other famous names. Yeah, different man. So they were telling Prabhupada, trying to encourage Prabhupada to come there. However, Srila Prabhupada told them, oh no, I have to go to Russia. I'm going to Moscow. Prabhupada also told her, preaching Krishna consciousness in the snows of Moscow is sweeter than the sweetest mango. Okay, so you all want to go to Moscow? Just see back to Chaitanya Swami and he will arrange. You can go there, go and preach in the snows of Russia. Our Gopal Krishna Maharaj is also very much involved in Russia. So both of them can help you. You like to preach. Get the real mangoes, the real sweet thing. Right? So now we're going to hear from His Holiness Bhaktivinoda Swami Maharaj. You tell us something about the significance of this place or the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. You're hearing a lot about food. We heard about the wedding feast. We're hearing about mangoes. You're all thinking about breakfast probably. But we're going to another place before breakfast. And we're going to see a drama also before breakfast. Okay, so we're going to Gorodaha from here. And after Gorodaha, then we're very close to Bhaktivinoda's home. So please don't move independently. Wait, let's all go. When we leave after breakfast, we'll all go together to Bhaktivinoda Thakur's house. There's many other different speakers coming and everything. Please try to stay together as one group. Don't go off independently. It's only a very short walk from Gorodaha to Bhaktivinoda Thakur's house, but please stay together. Let's all go together. First we're going to Gorodaha. We'll have a program there, speaking there, drama there, and then breakfast. Hare Krishna. Are the Delhi devotees here for the drama? Huh? Rasa Raj Prabhu? Is he there? He was taking prasadam 10 minutes ago. Rasa Raj? Huh? Not here. Okay. I want to inform all of you. Yesterday, you know, we went to Nisringapalli, but we didn't talk at the Nisringadev temple. We had the program at that Gaudiya Math temple because he had a nice big construction and many devotees could be seated there, and we had nice facility for the Prabhachan. So some devotees, they didn't know, and they went straight to the Nisringadev temple, and they were waiting there. And then when we all came there, we didn't talk. We only had darshan and moved on. And they were calling out Mayapur and saying, what kind of parikram is this? There's no katha. You just come and give obeisances and go away. We should stay and talk at the place. They didn't know that we had our talking. We spent quite a bit of time, and there were several speakers there. But at the Gaudiya Math temple, they missed all the Prabhachan. So similarly today, with Bhaktivinoda Thakur's house, it's a smaller place. It's not a lot of room. It will be impossible for all of us to be accommodated in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's house. But if we just go around the corner at the Surabhi Kunj place, where there's also a temple coming up, it's under construction, then we can have a program and we'll have the katas, we'll have the lectures all there. So we just go to Bhaktivinoda Thakur's house and have darshan there, and then we'll move on around the corner to Surabhi Kunj. And from there, it's only a 3 minutes walk to the evening camp, where we'll have our program, where you have lunch prasadam, where you'll be spending the night. Okay, so Gora Dahab, this past time I was hearing Pancharatna Prabhu speaking about Gajendra, and I was thinking, he was saying, oh, that crocodile is not a devotee. But I don't know, I don't really agree with that. Some people say, no, he's really a devotee. He got liberated before Gajendra, right? When the Lord came on the back of Garuda, who did he liberate first? The crocodile. Yeah, Gajendra was there. Why you liberate him? What about me? Why did the crocodile get liberated first? Because he'd taken shelter of the feet of a devotee. Yeah, he had really tight grip of Gajendra's feet and he wouldn't let go. So when you take shelter of the feet of the devotee, you hold on to the feet of the devotee like that. Don't ever let go. Then you'll be liberated quickly. And we see also in Krishna Leela, I was thinking about the Vijayadara liberated, right? That big serpent came out and he was swallowing up Nanda Maharaj, and Krishna just came and with a touch of his foot, then the big serpent was transformed into a demigod. He was a demigod Vijayadara, and he was liberated. So just by the touch of the lotus feet of the Lord, one can be liberated. What to speak of one who chants the holy name of the Lord? How much powerful, how much benefit we can get. So we can all be liberated from this material existence if we faithfully take shelter of the holy name. Remember, we're here in Godramdweep. This is a place of kirtan. It's very nice. The kirtan is going on very well. The ladies are having a nice kirtan. And the men are also doing wonderful kirtan. But we would like the ladies to please try to stay with the ladies. I know some of the ladies say, no, I want to be with Guru Maharaj. But Guru Maharaj wants the ladies to be with the other ladies. So please try to remember, please try to keep separate. Remember, many people are watching and they will be looking, they notice these things and they will criticize us. So please, the Russians, the Bengali parties, they all have very nice organization. They have very wonderful Harinam. They're very cultured. We want to make this international parikram party in a similar manner. So please try to remember, the ladies should be with the other ladies and the brahmachari, the men in the front doing their kirtan. And it's very nice. The women are also having wonderful kirtan. I was listening, I was following, and I could hear their kirtan. It was very sweet. So please try to remember these things. Maharaj, would you like to give us some of your knowledge, the benefit? Because Bhakti Nityananda Maharaj is, you know, he's a Dambasi. He knows the in and outs of everything. He can tell us a lot of things we've never heard before. So he's shy. He said, oh, I don't like to speak everywhere. People won't like it. But I think there's a nice opportunity here. Maharaj, please come and tell us something. Tell us the glories of Gaura. Which process of devotional service? Smaranam, yeah. We began in Antardweep, where we made the Sankalpa for the Parikrama. Antardweep, what's the process in Antardweep?
Atmanivedanam,
full surrender, right? And then we were supposed to go, the Parikrama traditionally, you should go from Antardweep, then it should begin in Simantadweep, which is a place of hearing. Because we have to hear first. In the beginning is hearing. And then from Simantadweep, then we go to Godramdweep for kirtan. We had a lot of kirtan last night. Those of you who went back, you missed a nice program. There was a lot of kirtan. The devotees from the Gurukula were doing kirtan for Lord Jagannath. And we had question and answers for the other devotees with Bhakti Nityananda Maharaj and myself. It's a regular program every year. We encourage all you devotees who are going back, that it's actually a real parikrama, is to stay out on the parikrama. Yeah, you sleep one night in each island. Sleep for one night in each island. You can feel the mood, develop the mood of that particular island. So you go back every day, you know, and then come out again in the morning. You miss a lot. Just want you to know. You miss a lot. You miss all the nice bath in the morning and ecstatic Mongol arti. Anyway, so we encourage, stay out from Godramdweep, where we do a lot of kirtan. Then we have come to Madhyamdweep for remembering. So smaranam, that is certainly very important. If we hear and chant, then we can remember better. Without hearing, we won't be able to chant and we can't remember. But hearing and remembering help us for this process of smaranam. Smartavyam satatam Vishnu, Vishmartavyana jatukrit, sarve vidhi nishedashur etayore bakinta. Always remember Vishnu or Krishna. Lila smarana. We were talking in Naimisharanya, we were hearing Gaurakatha. We want to remember the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. Is Mahamantra Prabhu here? He was going to give us some Gaurakatha. Already gone, huh? Okay. So we want to remember the pastimes of the Lord. We heard Jaipataka Maharaj tell us a little bit about some pastimes in Koladweep, how Lord Varaha appeared there in the Satya Yuga. There was one Brahmana and he was worshipping Lord Varaha. Lord Varaha is very important form of the Lord, actually. I was reading recently how in South India there was one state that the coin was called Varaha. They use the currency of Varaha. we have rupees and we have dollars. But in the past, everything was based on the Lord. The money was also in relation to the Lord. Everything was Varahas. The worshipful deity of many kings, Lord Varaha Dev. very important deity. So Lord Varaha appeared in Koladweep, which is now presently called Navadweep Don. And there's a deity of Lord Varaha there
in one mutt.
Yeah, there's one mutt with the Lord Varaha deity worshipped there.
Devananda
Gaudiya mutt, right. So Lord Varaha appears there in Koladweep. We had the in the Srimad Bhagavatam we have the appearance of Lord Varaha. Lord Varaha appears in the Srimad Bhagavatam, describes he comes from the nostril of Lord Brahma. But he appeared also in Navadweep Dham to bless his devotee. So we are going to go to Navadweep Dham and do parikrama. We're going to continue our parikrama there in Koladweep. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, what is the name of Navadweep Dham? What is the name used? Kulia Shripat. Okay, because in the Chaitanya Charitamrita you don't see Koladweep, but you see Kulia. It's often referred to. So they're talking about Navadweep. So before Bhaktivinoda Thakur, it was thought that the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was actually in Navadweep. And there is a temple there, which we don't go to it, of course, because they are claiming that is the actual birth site of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So it was Bhaktivinoda Thakur who brought us over to this side of the Ganga to show the actual birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then by the preaching of Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati, he could convince everyone that actual birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was here in Mayapur. He even, we heard how he brought up the governor of Bengal, right? Came all the way out here, out to Mayapur. I remember coming out to Mayapur in the 1970s. It used to take 5-6 hours. It was like a dirt road the whole way. There was hardly any concrete, you know? It was really difficult. But could you imagine what it must have been like 100 years ago? When the governor of Bengal came out. So what preaching that is, you know, nowadays to get the governor of Bengal to come, even with the good, you know, very difficult. But Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati was such a great preacher and so influential, he could bring the most prominent Western people out to Mayapur to establish the authenticity of the holy place of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So we have so much to be indebted to these great personalities. We're performing parikram. We want to remember all of these things. I was reading in the pastimes of Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati that at one point even he was bringing parikrama parties to Navadweep and they were stoned, right? Yeah, they were attacked. The people as they came, the people were throwing stones on them. So a lot of opposition was there against all of this opposition. And there were no foreigners there to stone, you know, it was all Bengali people. And still they got opposition. We think sometimes, oh, it's just because we're foreigners or we're some Videshi society or something, so they don't like. But even in Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati's time, there was opposition. But he overcame all of these obstacles and established this Krishna consciousness movement. So we want to remember all of these difficulties. We want to be determined to push on Krishna consciousness. We have a long way still to go. The TOVP has a long way to go. Need a lot of money. We have to do a lot of Harinam Sankirtan. So we're going to go this afternoon when we cross over, we'll do Harinam through the streets until we come to Jagannath Das Babaji's Samadhi and Bhajan Kutir. It's not a very big place and the pathways are very narrow. I don't know, we'll try to speak there, but it may be difficult.
Our next day,
Yeah, there's no, they've reconstructed that whole budget in Cloutier from when we used to go there in the past, in the last year or two. They put in a whole new structure, concrete everywhere, and it's made a lot less space. We can't get many devotees in there. Everything's very narrow. And when we go to Vishnupriya's deity, the Dameshwar Mahaprabhu, again, it's also very small. We, in the beginning, when we used to go to these places, you know, we were not many devotees, so it wasn't a problem. You know, 100 devotees, 150 devotees, not a big deal. We were thinking, you know, wow, it's really crowded in here. But now, you know, 1,000, over 1,000, 1,500 devotees, it's no question, you know. So we'll just be going to these places, we'll have darshan, and then we'll be going to, what's the we're staying in, where? Pratapnagar, right. Yeah, we have our own ISKCON property at Pratapnagar. It's a big area, big land, and some forest even there. Very nice place. However, it's 3 kilometers out of Navadvip. So, you know, after you Dameshwar, you still have to walk 3 more kilometers. It's not difficult. I think everybody will find the way to follow. Even the rickshaw wallahs will know where we're going. So if you get a little lost, just take a rickshaw and Pratapnagar. That's where we want to go. We have our big camp there and everything will be there. We'll have the talks there. Maybe Delhi devotees could do dramas because we usually had a drama at Jagannath Das Babaji's Bhajan Kutir there. So if we can have a drama. Name is Abhiarchi, wife of a devotee called Govindadatta, and she's at this moment just on the point of leaving her body. So we're asking all the devotees to chant the Maha Mantra for her, to bless her. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. So with the blessings of all of you, we hope she will have a safe journey out of this body, on back home. Okay, Maharaj, want to say something? Okay, so, as I remember, at Puskar, there was an elderly Brahmana in poor health. He could not walk, but he very strongly desired to go to Puskar. Now, usually going to Puskar, but why do people go there? Most people think you go to a holy place to take a bath, right? That's it. The general idea that we will go to the holy place, we'll take a bath there, we'll get rid of our sins. So he was thinking also, he really wanted to go there to Puskar and have his bath, but he was old and poor health, he cannot walk, people have to carry him everywhere. You know, just like if you have to come on Parikrama and you can't walk. Okay, we have the rickshaws, you can get a rickshaw, but sometimes even the rickshaws have difficulty coming some places. So this Brahmana, he couldn't find anyone to take him to Puskar. Nobody was willing. It's a long way to go from Navadvip. He's living here in the Dham. He wanted to go to Puskar to bathe there. Nobody wanted to go all the way there to Rajasthan. You know, a long walk. Of course, people used to walk a lot more than they do nowadays. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu walked all over India. He didn't mind walking, he was a great walker. We also should get used to walking more. We don't need all these vehicles. Prabhupada liked to walk every morning. Could go for a japa walk with him. But this Brahmana, he couldn't walk. He needed people to carry him. Nobody is willing to do that service. So he was praying and praying how to go. I really want to go there. I want to get rid of my sins. I want to have my bath there in Puskar. But then the personality of Puskar appeared before him and revealed to him that I'm here in Navadvip Dham. You don't have to go all the way there to Rajasthan. That place in Rajasthan, that is just the expansion of my original Puskar, which is here in Navadvip Dham. You can take your bath here and you'll get thousands of times more benefit than going all the way there to Rajasthan. So the Brahmana was so happy to get this information, he was able to go to that lake, which is now not much of a lake anymore, but used to be. In his time, it was a very nice lake. We're trying to maintain the holy places in the Dham. It is not very easy. So many people come here, have come here, moved into this Dham. The original residents of the Dham, practically, they're not here. They've all moved to the big cities, the Bengali. Just yesterday, I was saying to Bhakti Nityananda Maharaj that all these people mind us coming through their village. He said, no. They said, they're all Bangladeshis. I was surprised. I thought, well, you know, I was thinking they're all native Bengalis. But he said, no. He said, they've all come from Bangladesh. He said, most of the people here in this village, they're from Bangladesh. The local people, where did they all go? Many have gone to Calcutta, Delhi. When we go to Belpakur also, you'll see Belpakur used to be a nice village full of brahmanas. They've all gone away to the cities. I remember I was in Calcutta airport and I met this one officer in the airport, very nice young man, well educated, and he was talking to me. He said, yes, our family home is there in Belpakur. But he said, we never go there. That's a village, you know. But these are the holy places. What's happening now in the holy places, people are coming in. You've got chicken farms and coal mines and brick factories. We're losing the opportunity of being able to visit many of these holy places. So it's important, you know, that you appreciate how much work is involved in maintaining this holy Dham. We do donate regularly for the to try to purchase more and more property. We purchased, right, some land?
Many places already we purchased. Today in Jannagar, this year we are not sitting that under the banyan tree. Jannagar not means not only that place, whole area is Jannudip. So we'll sit our Prabhupada land. We'll sit this year. We'll take prasad. Prabhupada. And big plot. We got big plot.
So we want you to understand how many different projects are going on here in Mayapur. It's not only TOVP, maintaining the Holy Dham, the Shantipur program. There's so many different things going on, you know. It's such a big thing. That's why we say if we do this Navadvip Dham Parikram every year, the whole world will become Krishna conscious. We can see so many nice things developing from this. So we're going to walk now. We ask all of the devotees, please remember the format, the code, how we want to go, because later on after Prasadam, we're going to be going Harinam Sankirtan. We're going to go through Navadvip, which is a very conservative place. A lot of brahmanas are there, and people will really be noticing. So we have, first of all, in the beginning, we have the banner. And then behind the banner comes Srila Prabhupada. And then comes Nittai Pada Kamala, or Gaur Nittai deities. After that, we have the Gurukula Bhava. Every year we are seeing wonderful performances. They take their performances very seriously. You can see
perfect costumes, everything so well arranged. So you can understand behind this, there's some very nice, very, very qualified managers. And actually, I'd like to introduce you to the headmaster, headmistress actually. Her name is Padma Radhika Manaji. And she runs the school along with the help of her good husband, Radha Vinod Sharu. Please come up, Manaji. This is Padma Radhika Devi Dasi. She's the headmistress. Every year we see different performances, wonderful costumes, very nice, very well rehearsed. All by young children, all students in the school. And it's an English medium school. And the enrollment in the school is now how many hundreds? 600. 600 students. Oh, Radha Vinod Prabhu tells me that the children were having exams until yesterday afternoon, so they only rehearsed once evening. Children come from all over Goramandala. They come from Krishnanagar. Some children come as far as 36 kilometers from the school. So every day coming and going 36 kilometers to take advantage of the nice education at our Bhaktivedanta National School. So we're very grateful to both Padma Radhika Manaji and Radha Vinod Prabhu. They're doing wonderful service there. Some of the teachers are also here. Radha Kanta. Yeah, I thought Radha. Totally Radha. Yeah, and Prabhu tells me also, not all the children are Hindu, they have 18 Muslim children also. So, very nice, wonderful achievement. The school developing so well. So here we are now, Champakahati. We're still in Koladweep. Navadvip Dham is in the form of a lotus flower, 8-petaled lotus, and in the center of Navadvip Dham is Antardvip at the Yoga Peak. So in Antardvip, the Yoga Peak, we were performing that the mode of service is full self-surrender. We should have went to Simantadweep. We'll be going there on the last day of the parikram. We did go to the second place. We began our parikram on the second place, which was Godrundweep, the place of Kirtan. From Godrundweep, we came to Majjhamdweep. Majjhamdweep was the place of remembering the Lord. After Majjhamdweep, we were coming to Koladweep. Koladweep is Pada Sevana, and we'll be moving on from here into Ritudweep. Ritudweep, the mode of devotional service, which is represents is Archana. So like this, we're covering the different petals of the lotus flower. It's pointed out how the Lord appears in each of the four yugas. In Navadvip Dham, in the Satya Yuga, where does the Lord appear? In Satya Yuga, the Lord also appears in Navadvip Dham. Which form of the Lord? Varahadev. Varahadev is one form. There's another form also. Nrisingadev. Right. Yeah, it comes in Nrisingadev also as Varahadev. And then he comes in Treta Yuga as Lord Ramachandra in Mother Drumadweep. We haven't been there yet. We'll be going there tomorrow, I think. Lord Rama comes in Treta Yuga, then Dwapara Yuga.
Krishna!
Lord comes as Krishna where?
Vrindavan.
No, Navadvip Dham he comes, not Vrindavan. Where did Krishna come in Navadvip Dham? Yeah, we were just here. So Mudra girl, right, he came to, we saw the drama, he came to meet Sumudra Sen. So Lord Krishna comes also in this island, in this Kovadweep. And then he comes also in the Kali Yuga.
Dwaraka.
So in each of the four yugas, the Lord appears here in Navadweep Dham. We want to appreciate these things. Here we are now, Champakahati, the market for champakas. Where are all the champak flowers? What happened to all the champak flowers? There's a sabji market, there's a fish market probably somewhere. These kind of markets. Where are the champak flowers? We want to restore these things. If we get the facility, if we get the opportunity, we would like to see again the beauty of this Champakahati. Many champak flowers everywhere. It is the Champakalas that would come here and collect the flowers, make garlands, offer to Krishna. And this is how this place got its name. So we are fortunate. We can see very special deities here. The deities of Gaur Gadarha. We're going to ask His Holiness Bhakti Nityananda Swami Maharaj to come. Did he disappear? Maharaj will tell us everything on the history of these deities. You would come and tell us about Gaur Gadarha. Yeah, about the deities. And similarly, we see also Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, that he was a great scholar, the greatest logician of his time. He was a Grihastha, but at the same time he was a very renowned Grihastha. He said he was like a Kshetra Sannyasi practically. But he was teaching the Mayavadi Sannyasis the philosophy of Vedanta Sutra. The greatest philosophy is there in Vedanta Sutra. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was teaching this. But then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to Jagannath Puri and the two of them met. So, of course, Sarvabhauma was eager. He got some mercy from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He did some Agyata Sukriti. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu entered the temple at Puri, he was in ecstasy and he became unconscious. So Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya understood this was some ecstatic symptom. It was not some ordinary. He was no ordinary person and he was not just putting on a show or anything. So Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya had the unconscious body of Lord Chaitanya taken to his home. And he was taking care for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu while he was in the unconscious state. So after the other devotees came, when Lord Nityananda and all the other devotees came, then they couldn't find Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but then they heard that he had been taken to the home of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. So they went there, and by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, they were able to revive Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was happy to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and to learn about his identity. He could understand he was a sannyasi in the line of Shankar Acharya. So Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was concerned to educate these young sannyasis. Mahaprabhu was only 24 years old. That's a young sannyasi, isn't it? We don't have any 24-year-old sannyasis in ISKCON.
We used to, yeah.
Where are they now? Well, Jatadaka Maharaj was a teenager when he took sannyasi. What age were you when you took sannyasi?
21.
Okay, so anyway.
24 when you try. So Mahaprabhu, a very young sannyasi, a Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, very elderly gentleman, expert in logic and philosophy, and willing to educate the sannyasis. In fact, he was doing it because the Shankaracharya sannyasis reside there in Puri. There's a Shankaracharya mutt there. So he was educating them in Vedanta philosophy. So he wanted to educate Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So for 7 days he was speaking. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, being a polite, well-mannered, cultured person, he could not refuse such an offer. So he had to sit and listen, and he did for 7 days. For 7 days, Sarvabhauma was speaking, and there was no questions. So Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya became a little perplexed that I'm speaking so many things, but you don't respond. I don't know if you understand or not. You don't have any questions. So Mahaprabhu exclaimed that, well, to tell you frankly, I understand Vedanta Sutra, but what you're explaining, the way you're explaining, that is something very different. That is some, you have a very different understanding of Vedanta. What you're explaining is very twisted, complex. No one will understand what you're talking about. Not surprising, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya is actually Brihaspati, come to take part in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes. Brihaspati means the spiritual master of the demigod. So great philosopher. Great philosophers, they speak so much, they speak so learned, we cannot understand. That's a problem. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu expressed that this was what was happening, that Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's explanation of the Vedantas were so complex and so difficult to understand that he was also not appreciating what he was talking about. But Mahaprabhu did say that I already know what is Vedanta. And Mahaprabhu then began to explain, of course. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya then asked Mahaprabhu that, okay, that why don't you explain this Atmarama sloka for me? I want to hear how you explain that verse. Right? We can all recite together. Atmaramaschamunayo.
Atmaramaschamunayo.
Nirgranta apirukrame.
Nirgranta apirukrame.
Kurvanti ahaitakim bhaktim.
Kurvanti ahaitakim bhaktim.
Itam bhuto gunahare. So this is a very interesting verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, because it describes that even one who is Atmarama, meaning one who has realized himself to be the soul, to be different from the material body, that even such an elevated, liberated soul is attracted to hear the glories of the Supreme Lord. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was asked to explain this. So he said to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, yes, I can explain, but I want to hear your explanation first. So then Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya began to explain, and he took each and every word of this sloka of the Srimad Bhagavatam, and he gave it meaning, several meanings. He could explain each and every word. Just like we're told, Prabhupada often told us how his own Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati Thakur Prabhupada, explained the first verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam for 1 month. And he said he could have gone on speaking on the same verse. He had not he had not exhausted the topics for discussion contained therein. For 1 month he spoke on the same verse. Prabhupada often told us how every word in the Srimad Bhagavatam is full of meaning. You know, we're trying to understand one sloka. Very difficult. But every word has so much meaning. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya explained each and every word. And Mahaprabhu was very pleased. And he congratulated Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya with his explanation. That you are really Brihaspati. Nobody else but you, Brihaspati, could speak such philosophy with so much depth and so much understanding. But then Mahaprabhu went on to speak. How many meanings?
21.
Look, Kavichandra Swami tells us that...
Sorry to interrupt. Spoke 64 later.
Yeah. Later on he also explained the same verse to Sanatana Goswami. But that was later. When he explained to Sanatana Goswami, at that time Lord Chaitanya gave 64 meanings of the Atmarama verse. And when he explained it to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, Kavichandra Swami tells us he gave it 21 meanings, which did not include any of the 9 meanings which Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya had given. So hearing all of these explanations from Lord Chaitanya, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was dumbfounded. He had never ever heard such erudition greater than his own. He always considered himself to be the greatest scholar of the world. But hearing Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu speak, he was really overwhelmed and dumbfounded. He didn't know what to think. However, Sarvabhauma was fortunate that he had one brother-in-law. Right? Yeah, Gopinath Acharya was his brother-in-law. And Gopinath Acharya was a great devotee and he had full faith in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and he understood the identity of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as the Supreme Lord. However, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was not convinced. He was arguing with Gopinath Acharya, how is it possible the Lord doesn't come in Kali Yuga? In the scriptures it said the Lord is called Tri Yuga. He only comes in 3 Yugas. Gopinath Acharya, however, defeated him also. He got 2 defeats, one after the other. Gopinath Acharya told him, you don't know the scriptures, Prabhu. Don't you know the Lord comes in every age? Yuge, right? The Lord is coming in every age. He's also coming in the Kali Yuga. And this Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he is none other than that Supreme Lord.